Am I audible?
Yes, Vicky, you are audible.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Good evening, everyone. My name is Vicky Kumar Sharma, and I'll be taking today's session. So I request everyone to go to joinpd.com and use this code RDZFSK. So this peer deck I'll be using to show the slides. All of you kindly go to joinpd.com and use this code RDZFSK. I could see three of you are connected, five. So there are 21 students. I could see like 10 of you are connected here. So can any of you try to speak? I don't know if you are able to speak or not. Can you
hello, sir.
unmute your? Yeah.
Yes, sir, we are able to unmute. Yes.
Okay. So yeah, I could see like 10 of you are connected. So as soon as like around some 15 student gets connected, we'll start the session. Okay.
Should we
So
join joinpd.com?
yeah, go to joinpd.com and use this code RDZFSK.
Okay, sir. So we will not submit our answer on that quiz.
You can actually do that too. So this is like solve with instructor. So it's like you can take up the question like whichever comes on the slide, and you can solve according along with me and give the answers there.
Okay, sir, sure.
Or like however it's fine. Yeah, so I could see like 15 of you are connected. There are some 24 participants, like 22. So yeah, so basically I'll start the session. Yeah, so today we'll be discussing maths term one exam, which is and you are also live on mock, so I'll be instructing you. So it's basically solve with instructor. So we can take up the questions and solve. You can solve along with me and submit your answers accordingly. So plan for the session will be, I think most of you will all be already be aware of it. So
Yes, sir, we are
all,
family.
yeah, so I no need to repeat because most of you have already joined here. And this will be the format wherein I'll be giving you a question on the left hand side of the box, and on the center box you will see what is that question that you have to answer. And right hand side on desktop you will see a box like this wherein you'll get an option to give your response or like in whichever format. And here if you are using a mobile, you will get at the bottom. Okay, so this is one sample screenshot, which is this is how it going to appear. So this is a test problem. So I want to see you guys responding to this so that I will get an idea like from it. So the question is, what is your favorite color? I think like you are able to see this on your periodic screen, is it? If so, please answer. Yeah, so I can see like 10 responses. Okay. Okay. Yeah, nice. All right. So good. So I could see like 28 of you have already joined, of which like 17 of you are answering. Black, pink, seven. Okay, all right, nice. So this was a test question. So it appears like it's working fine. So now we have a first question here. So you can see in your mock questions. I don't know which question number it is on your mock where you're giving this. So the first question is, a carom board, which is in the form of a square, is given over here, and A, B, C, D are the corners of that carom board, and F, G, H, E are the midpoints of the respective line segment shown in the figure. And if we choose A as the origin, and on the right we take it, let's say x-axis, positive x-axis, and above this we take the positive y-axis, and the above means above A. So then you have to give the answers for this. Like choose which of the following is or are correct. So I'll give you some 5 minutes. You have to answer.
Sir, meanwhile, can I ask some question?
Yeah, sure.
Sir, I am not able to identify cross digits, if you can help me.
Sorry?
Sir, cross digits.
Cross daisies.
Yeah.
What is it?
Sir, it is type of edges like forward edges, backward edges, and cross digits.
Okay. Fine, fine. I got it. Okay, fine. I'll take up this later on, like in the
Okay,
end.
sir. Yeah. Okay, thank you.
Px, qx, c, a4. After subtracting, what will be the polynomial look like?
Okay. So I could see like most of you are giving answer as A, definitely A, and some of you are giving A, C, D, A, B. Some of you are giving all of the options are right. Okay. So actual answer, like all the options above are right. So how is this done? Okay. So are you able to speak?
Yes, sir.
Yes,
Yes,
sir.
okay. All right.
Yes, sir.
Fine. So basically for this question, all the options are right here. So what we have to do here is, first of all, we need to find out the coordinates for each vertices. So each point. So for A, since this was origin, it's going to be 0, 0, right? And if you see B, C, D, these are the corners of the squares. And we know that square, for squares, all the sides are equal. And here, since they are in the same plane, so what we can say is, using the same symmetry, what will be the coordinates of B? It's gonna be 10, 0, right? Do anybody have doubt in this?
No, sir.
Okay. Similarly, for C, it's going to be 10, 10. It's because, from the same symmetric property. So this is going to be 10, 10, and this is going to be 10, 0. Okay.
Yes, sir.
All good for now? Yeah. Now, how do we find the vertices for F, G, H, E? Okay. So now, since these are the midpoints, right? Now, F is the midpoint of AB, right?
Yes, sir.
And G is the midpoint of BG, and H is the midpoint of CD. Similarly, E is the midpoint of AD, right? Since this is the midpoint, so we can use that, the formula what we have learned, like the coordinates of X, and this is the midpoint. So it's going to be MX. So here M, so it's basically X coordinate is going to be X1 plus X2 by 2, and Y coordinate is going to be Y1 plus Y2 by 2, correct? So what we are going to get here is, so 10 plus 0, that makes it 10 by 2 is nothing but. Hello. Actually, this is a mistake here. Like it should be 0 comma 10. The coordinate of B should be 0 comma 10. Did you notice?
Yes, sir.
Cord. Yes, sir,
Yeah.
it should be 0, 10.
Right.
X-axis should be 0, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I don't know if I can annotate here, so I cannot annotate. So all right. So this is fine. So basically, this is 0 comma 10. So this is not going to be this. So it's 0 comma 10, all right. So now what we have to, similarly, what is going to be for F, for G? What are the coordinates for G?
G should be 5, 10. It's right.
Okay. And why is it so? Because using the same formula. Similarly for
It's
H, it's going,
midpoint, yeah.
yeah, similarly, it's going to be 10 plus 10 by 2. So that's 20 by 2, which makes it 10, right? And for Y
Yes.
coordinate, it's going to be 10 plus 0, which makes it 5. Right,
Yes,
so
sir.
as of now,
Ten
it's
comma
easy.
ten.
Okay, now similarly, what we get it for E as well, right? So we got the coordinates for all of this. So in the option, as you could see previously, it was asked. So here, the first option is we will come to the first option. Segment line segment GH intersects the inner square at 6 comma 9 and 9 comma 6. So that is something we have to find out, and it is GH, right? So GH is somewhere here, right? And we have, as for now, we are able to locate what are the coordinates of G and H, right? So using these two points, so we can use two point formula for the line, right? And we can get the equation for this GH, correct? Anybody? Are you with me? Do you want some more explanation?
Yes, sir, we
Yes,
understand.
sir.
Yeah.
You understood. All right. So GH, so you will be able to get the line or equation of a line, right? Of this GH line segment GH, and which is something going to be Y is equals to minus X plus 15. So when you solve this, when you substitute this value. Okay, so you can try this, you will get this equation. Now what you can do is, now since we need to find out what are the coordinates of this, right? So at this point, that is at 6, 9, as you can see here, forget for now the point. So what we can see here at this point is how far is this point? What will be the y coordinate of this point? Can you tell me? Just
so
like
we
this.
We can insert 6. We can replace x with 6, and we can find the value of y.
No, how do you know the value of 6? You don't know the value of 6. You don't know value like, of 6. You know only 9, right? Because you know from A to B it is 10, correct?
Yes, sir.
So and this you know the width is 1. So if you reduce 1, it's going to be 9. So you only know y is equals to 9. So you can substitute this y in this formula of
this equation, and then we will get the value
get
of
the
x.
Value of x. Similarly, when you come to this part, the other point, that is 9, 6, how can you do? Because you know the length AD is 10, right? And width of this thing is 1, correct? So if you subtract that, it becomes 9. So this part will be 9. That is something you will know, right? And that you will substitute there again in the same equation of a line to get the value that comes out to be 6, right? So we get these 2 points, right?
Yes.
As if now all good, correct?
Okay. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Now what? Now, the other part of the question was F, H and G, E are perpendicular to each other. So if all of you have come through, like, you know, like if you have a maths background, you know, like symmetry of basically a square, right? So if you go through the symmetry of square, so basically what happens here is, since these are the center points, right? And they are bisecting each other, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So in other words, you know, it's like if you see at the figure, you can directly say, yeah, these are perpendicular to each other, since these are the midpoints and these are the midpoints, right? So you can still confirm this using the property, like you can use the property that M1 times M2 is equals to minus 1, right? That property you can use and get the answer. So how do you do that? You can find the slope of GE. What will be the slope of GE?
1. No, sir. No. Infinity.
Yeah,
infinity.
Because it's 10 by 0, right?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
That makes it infinity. So now if I can substitute this formula over here, so if I say M1 is infinity, so what should be my M2 here? M2 should give me 0, correct?
0, yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, so now I can use this again here. So now let's see what is slope of FH. So can you tell me what is the slope of FH?
0.
Yes.
5 minus 5 by 10, yeah.
So that's something which satisfies this property. So that is something we got from you, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now another thing was the distance between M and E. Okay. So what will be the distance between M and E? So what I want you to do is, so basically, see, whenever you get a complex problem like this, of course it takes time, right? So what you can do is you can analyze using the symmetry of this. Like, now if I come to H, okay, I'll just try to annotate if it is possible. Okay. Can you tell me what will be the coordinate for this point? Use the symmetric property. If this is 9, 6, what will be the coordinates for this?
9, 4.
7, 6. Sorry.
9, 4.
Yeah.
9, 4. Why 4?
Because we are going 2 points below.
So basically, if this is the thing, you're going 1 point above here and 1 point above here. So this makes it 9, 4, right? Yeah. Similarly, if this is 9, 4, okay, now I can say that like these are the things which is happening. Can you tell me what are the coordinates for this?
4, 9.
So it's going to be what?
4, 9.
Okay. So now this is 6. So this is going to be 4, 9, isn't it? Okay. So you got this. If this is 4, 9, this is somewhat, you will be able to identify this point and this point as well, because this is something which falls in this, right? So now understand this from symmetry itself. If this was, can you tell me what will be the coordinates for this? Like using the same property like this, what will be the coordinates for this one?
4, 1.
6, 1. That?
Okay, for M you are saying, is it?
For
yes,
M
sir.
Is
M
4,
is 4, 1,
1
and
yes,
the other one is 6, 1.
Okay, very good. So you got the coordinates for M, right? So now having known that, So now you have to find out what is distance between ME. So now you got the coordinates of M and you know the coordinates of E. So can you use the distance formula and get the answer for that?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so can you tell me what is the value?
Root 2.
Yeah. So all of you got that?
Yes, sir.
Anybody who did not get this? If not, we can move to the next part. Okay. So I could see like most of you got it. All right. So next, to address the next question, I just want to give you a brief example of a question and then you can address that question. Okay. Now you have to consider this equation, f of x is equals to log x square plus x minus 1 equals to 0. And we need to find the number of solution in an interval 0 to infinity. Okay. So if any of you are like very smart enough, can you just seeing this, can you give me the answer quickly, like within 30 seconds?
Will it be 2?
Okay, let's not take much time for this. Okay, so I'll take you to the next thing. So how is this going to happen? So in the question, it was given to you log x square plus x minus 1, right? And that is equal to 0. So at when it will be equal to 0, can you tell me? When log of this thing, x square plus x minus 1 will be equals to 0. When x square plus x minus 1 is equals to 1, correct?
Yes,
correct. So that implies what? I can take this, the one which is on the right hand side, I can take it to the left hand side. So it turns out to be x square plus x minus 2 equals to 0, right? Now what I'll do is I'll find the roots for this. So now I can see like this is very easily factorizable, right? X square plus x minus 2. So I can write this as x square, right? Plus 2x minus x minus 2, and then I can factorize, correct? Do any of you have a problem with this? If you have a problem, just tell it, okay? If you don't tell it, I'll assume like you know it, okay? So yeah, okay, fine.
Sir, yeah. I have a doubt.
Yes, please.
After you got the two roots, I do not understand how you plotted the log functions.
Forget about this plotting part for time being. Okay. And we are not interested in plotting at all. This is just to show you that thing. Okay. So
but
why,
sir? With plotting, it will be a lot easier to understand the domain and range, I guess.
No, see. That is fine. That is fine. So why I took up this question and why I'm not giving you stress towards this is it's very much oriented towards your interim exam. Okay? So what I want you to do is see here, this is like very quadratic function. What if it is x to the power of 5 and some, you know, a big equation? Plotting and, you know, logarithmic function at that time becomes a very tedious task, right?
Yes.
At that time, we can just play with this. Let's not get into that part. So of course, what you told was right. If you want to find the domain and range, definitely the graph will be really helpful. And we have also given you exposure like how to go ahead with that, right? So what we can do for time being is for this kind of problem, we will not go to the graph, okay? This is just to show you a sample of it, okay?
Okay,
okay?
Sir.
We will not
Thank
go to the graph, okay? Yeah. So whenever if somebody asks you, okay, what is the solution for this? Let's not get into the graph part. Let's just get into the math of it, okay? So what we can do is the first approach will be like we can at what value it is going to be 0. Okay, so you'll find this quadratic equation, you will factorize this and you'll find there are only two roots, that is minus 2 and 1. What does this indicate? And so these are the two values wherein it touches the x-axis. So wherever it touches the x-axis, that becomes the solution for that, right? So at minus 2 and 1, what do we notice? That log of x square plus x minus 1 gives its solution, right? So, and the question was in the 0 to infinity, okay, how many solution we will get, right? So now you will get the solution. See, basically like in the domain, so we say like 0 to infinity, correct? So when it is, this thing is given and you see there are only two roots. Which are those two roots? Minus 2 and 1. So which one lies in this domain, 0 to infinity? How many values, how many roots are lying in this domain? I'll repeat again. Now a domain is given to us in the question, 0 to infinity, okay? And we need to find out how many solutions are there, like how many solutions are there in this domain. Now,
so I have a doubt.
Yes.
When we put in the value 1 in the quadratic equation, we will get the value 0. But log 0 is undefined. We cannot use 0 in the log function.
When you give 1, it will become 1. Substitute
so when
x
we
square.
Put when you, 1 in x square plus x minus 1.
You will get it as log 1. Log 1 is?
0.
Yeah, so that won't be undefined, right? Try
okay.
doing, yeah, right? Try doing 0 and then say x equals to 0, you get minus 1.
Then it becomes minus 1.
So that is something in the not domain. So see, whenever we ask you, so whenever we tell you like what is the solution in this given domain, all it means is like you have to find the roots for that, you know, for that quadratic equations which you obtain. And that roots gives you an idea, okay, like these are the x values wherein this log function intersects, right? Right?
Yes, sir.
This log function intersects only at these roots, right? So now I know there are two roots, basically at minus 2 and 1. Now I have been given a domain that is 0 to infinity, okay? In this domain, how many roots, where does it intersect? There are two values only, no? At minus 2 and minus 1. But in this domain 0 to infinity, 1 lies, right?
Yes,
correct?
Sir.
And that will be, that makes one solution, correct?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, did all of you are with me? Do you have any problem with this? Because if you have a problem, you tell me right now, I'll take up, okay? Because next I'll be
so actually, sorry to interrupt, but in the grade, I mean the mark quiz which is going now, the first mm-hmm. question is it a log 2 power log root 2 is there, is I mean is the root 2 power x minus 1 or root 2 is the base?
Root 2 is the base.
So thank you.
Okay, so any of you have a problem with this part of explanation?
No sir.
Okay, so all you have to do, I'll just summarize again, just take the log function, equate to 0, like equate to 0, and make an analysis when it is going to be 0. So log is going to be 0, log function is going to be 0 at 1, right? Then you equate it and then find the roots of whatever equations you get it, right? So when you get the roots from there, then what you can, so in these roots, now understand like what are the intersection points, like in the given domain, how many roots lies? So we got two roots, that is minus 2 and 1. And I can see like only one lies in this domain, like 0 to infinity. And therefore, there is only one solution. Okay? So in the question, what it was asked, we need to find the number of solution in an interval 0 to infinity. Right? So in 0 to infinity, just one solution lies. And that is 1. Okay? All good? Yes.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So now take up this question. Now, a function is given to you, f of x is equals to this. This is something in the mock. And so f of x is given to you, log of this, and then you have to find the number of solution in an interval 2 to infinity, okay? So you can use this hints given here. X to the power of 4, this is divisible by x square plus 6x plus 5. Try and understand why we have given this hint, x to the power of 4. Why is this minus 60 coming up? If this you understood, and if it is divisible by this, then you will be able to find all the roots. Correct? That is your second hint. And if you are able to find out the roots, then all you have to do is check that roots, whether it lies in this given interval. How many root lies in this given interval? And that will be the solution. So I'll give you 5 minutes for this.
So here in the question, it will be minus 60, right?
Yeah, right. I could see like 15 responses. I think some of you will be having problem with division of this, probably.
Just a few seconds, sir.
Yeah, sure.
Sir, can I ask a question? It's regarding question number one.
Okay, question number
it is, it's px equals to 2 to the power log root 2 x minus 1. So is it the root 2 is in base,
it's
or
base. It's in the base,
it's in the in, it doesn't look base. Like it is in the base.
So okay. Root 2 looks like it is root 2.
Log is written very small and 2 is written, very on the above of the log. So it is very difficult to...
On the similar size, right?
Okay. So you can consider...
Can you just clarify that?
Yeah, so it's basically 2 to the power of everything. And 2 to the power of log root 2 x minus 1. And then you have plus 1, okay? So it's 2 to the power of log of everything and root 2 is the base. Okay. For time being, you can take that. So it's basically root 2. It's not an intentional. It's like when we use this code, it turns out to be like that.
So
yeah,
the base of the logarithm is root 2.
Sorry?
So it is 2 to the power
the base log is root 2
of x minus 1.
Yeah, 2 to the power of log to the base root 2.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you, sir.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay.
If these sort of problems occur in the main exam, then it will be an issue, sir.
No, so if you're speaking, I'm unable to hear you. Sorry.
Oh, I'm sorry. It was muted. Okay. So basically, like, so step one, it's going to be log of this everything equals to zero. And as told earlier, this is going to be zero only when whatever log of whatever given here inside this function is equals to one. So clearly, on the left hand side, on the right hand side, you have one. When you take it to the left hand side, it becomes 60, as you can see here, right? So now this was something hint given to you in the problem, okay? And what you see from here is this was given, like, this part was, now this part was divisible by this x, this quadratic function x square plus 6x plus 5. So when you divide this, you get this thing. The next step is you have to factorize this quadratic function and this quadratic function. So when you factorize this, you get this value, that is x plus 5 times x plus 4 times x plus 1 times x minus 3. Okay, so now using this, I can get my roots, right? So I get these four roots, that is minus 5, minus 4, minus 1, and minus 3. And what was the domain given to us? 2 to infinity. In this 2 to infinity, how many roots? How many roots does it lie? Like, in 2 to infinity, minus 5, obviously it cannot lie. Minus 4, it's not going to lie. Minus 1, it's not going to lie. So it's only 3 which is going to lie. So it's just one solution, and which is 3. Clear? Any of you, any doubt?
No, sir.
Okay. So we can go ahead.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now a question is given to here. Now, external dimension of metallic cuboids are L, length, breadth, and height is given for you. So it's basically like a cuboid is given to you for which the external dimensions are given, that is length, breadth, and height, and the thickness is given to you, which is 2.5 units, and if the volume of the metal content in the cuboid is this, that is 300 times x minus 15, then what are the possible values of x? Okay.
Sir, yes. Sorry to disturb, sir, in the previous question.
Okay.
If the hint was not given for that example, this divides this.
That will be always given to you.
Okay.
Because that is nothing. That is because if we are giving you x to the power of 4, we are obliged to give you the roots because there is no way methods to find out the roots, right? It's just if it is factorizable to the nearest roots, then, you know, we generally don't give. But whenever it is higher polynomial, we give the roots.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
We give you some or the other thing. Yeah, definitely.
Yes.
So in this question, external dimensions are given to you and the thickness is given to you. And you are supposed to find out the volume of metal content. So it's basically the thickness of cuboid is that forms that volume of that metal. So that is something you have to find. Okay. So what is the possible values for, if that is the case, then what is the possible value? So I'll give you, like, again, 5 minutes.
I mean, this question options are correct. Are they like?
I think it's correct.
Give you 2 more minutes and then we can move it.
So here the metallic cuboid is hollow from inside, right? Hello?
I'm sorry, I just answered, but it was mute. So yeah, definitely. You guessed it right. So it's hollow from inside. Okay? You can start
Thank
now.
You, sir.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes.
Sir, don't you think that this the hollowness aspect of this cuboid should be mentioned explicitly?
Because I don't think so. Because here we are mentioning that the thickness of the metal is 2.5, right? So
yeah.
That is something we expect you to think like that. Like if the thickness of the metal is 2.5, then yeah, how is it should be like hollow then, right?
Okay, sir, yeah. Thank you.
So that means
it would not be metal that is contained in the cuboid, it will be air that is contained in the cuboid if it is hollow.
No, we are asking you what is the volume of the metal. We are not asking what is there inside.
Okay.
All right, so I could see like some of you, like 16 of you are giving given answers. Do you want some more time or should I?
So just few seconds, sir. Few seconds, sir.
Hello.
Yes.
Sir, I have only one doubt. What is the sir marks distribution for each week in maths?
For each what?
For each week in maths, marks distribution.
So that we will be sharing you soon. So we have prepared some minutes.
Oh.
Yeah, that will be sharing you.
So it's already given on the announcements section.
All right. So if it is already given, then it's announced. I'm sorry, I did not check that. So
even I got to know today.
Statistic, I think. Maths is not.
The math is also there. If you check the announcement forum, you'll find it in the recents, I'm sure.
Yeah, thank you.
On the portal?
On the discussion forums, they have the announcement forums also. I checked it over there.
Okay, okay. Could be possible.
Yeah. Thank
you. So, should I go with the solution now?
Second, sir. Just a second, sir.
So I'll give one more minute and then I'll take up.
Yes, sir. Okay. Yes,
sir. So we have to.
Sir, I think it will solve with you also. Time is limited.
Yeah, that's what. So, so I'm asking. All right. So
it is last session, I think, of mathematics.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah,
sure. So, yeah, so I'll take up this. So I'll go with the solution then. Yeah. So this is something, you know, like this is an open keyword, but don't consider this is open. All right. It's just to show you the thickness and, you know, the other dimensions of this. So basically, there, if you consider there are two cuboids, let's say consider there are two cuboids, okay, for which the outer dimensions are given, and also we have the inner dimension if we consider two cuboids. Now I'm saying it two cuboids just to give you an intuition, like how does it looks like, okay? So for outer dimension, so what the volume of metal contained inside will be nothing but the volume of cuboid with outer dimension minus the volume of cuboid with inner dimension. And that is something given to you as 300 times x minus 15, correct? Till now, all clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So now outer dimension of cuboid is given to you as?
Sir, how we will know that it is outer dimension? It has not been like I calculated it, it has any dimensions, like there is has been mentioned.
Your external dimensions are mentioned, right? External dimension of
cuboid. Okay, okay, got it.
Yeah? So that is something given to you, and another thing, a thickness is given to you, right? So the thickness is of 2.5. So if it is on one side, if it is 2.5, then the other side also it is 2.5, right? So all together, I'll just annotate this so that this becomes easier. So if this is 2.5, okay, so if this part is 2.5, this part is also 2.5, right? If let's say this was my width was like x minus 15. So this is x minus 15. Basically, I missed out you know, one from here. So if it was x minus 15, so all I have to do for to calculate what is the inner width of that thing will be x minus 15 minus 5. Correct? It's clear?
Clear to everyone? So one second, repeat.
All right, all right. So see, basically like our outer dimensions are given, for which the length is given as this part, and this part, right? Now, if I have to find out the inner dimension, that is inner dimension of this inner cuboid, let's say that's inner cuboid. So what is it's going to be length? So its length is going to be x minus 10 minus 5. Why minus 5? Because this thickness is going to be on the both side, right? Clear?
Yes. Yes, it is only 2.5, right? Because we already have the outer dimension, like the out of the cube. So even if it is a thickness of 2.5, we should subtract 2.5, right?
Okay, so now let's say this was our, this is our 2.5, this part, this is 2.5, this is also 2.5, right? If this is my length, the outer length was x minus 10, then what will be inner length? From here I'll subtract 2.5, and from here I'll subtract 2.5. So altogether I'll be subtracting 5 units, right? Similarly, I'll do for width and width and also for the height. Okay. So remember this open box, it does not mean this is open. It's just to show you, like, you know, it has that thickness. All right. It is closed box. Okay. So now then, if that is the case, then my L initially the outer, for outer dimension, it was x minus 10. Then for inner dimension, what it is going to be? X minus 15. Correct? No doubt till now? No doubt?
No, sir.
No, sir.
Similarly, the width is going to be for outer dimension, if it was x minus 15. So for inner dimension, it is going to be x minus 20. Similarly, for height, when it was x minus 20, then this is going to be x minus 25. Okay, so I got the dimension for my inner cuboid. All right, now all I have to do is take the difference for that, difference of these two, and then equate it to 300 times x minus 50. So that is something done here. All right, so the volume of metal contained will be equals to volume of cuboid with outer dimension, that is V1, volume V1 minus V2, that is nothing but 300 times x minus 50. Right, now we know the formula for volume of cuboid is length into breadth into height. So I can just simply find out what is my V1. So V1 is something shown here.
Given volume in the question is like 300 into x minus 15 is the volume of the hollow space.
Yeah, yeah. So that is, so this is for my outer dimension. This is the case. Right. And for inner dimension, this is the this is the volume. So I can subtract these two, V1 minus V2. I get something which is given to me, the volume. Now what I'll do is I can substitute these values and equate it to this. Now what I notice here is x minus 15 and x minus 15. It's common. X minus 15 is here and x minus 15 is also here. X minus 20 is here and x minus 20 is here. So what I notice is x minus 15 and x minus 20 is common on both sides. So I can just take out that thing here, right? All clear for now? Good?
Yes.
Okay. Okay. And then in this part, what I'll be left with? I'll be left with x minus 10, correct? And this minus will be as it is here. And over here, x minus 20 will be left, right? So when I solve this, what do I get? Only this part when I solve. What do I get? XX gets cancelled. Right? Minus into minus, this makes it plus. So plus 25 minus 10 will make it what? Minus 15, plus 15, which is shown here. Okay? Just a minute. So I think you are not able to see, right? Yeah, so you can see here. Now what I can solve this now. Your x minus 15 and x minus 15 gets cancelled on both hand side in last second step, right? And 300 by 15 is nothing but 20. So x minus 20 is equals to 20. So x is equals to 20 plus 20, which makes it x equals to 40. Do you have any doubt in this? Any of you, any doubt?
No, no.
Sir, this is just a clarification.
Okay, okay. Yeah, please go ahead. You're not audible.
Yeah, so when we subtract it, we add the 5.
Sorry, when you subtract?
Like x minus we are writing, so we are subtracting 5. In the sense, we are adding 5 to the 10, right?
When you're subtracting, right? Yeah, because that was minus. Yeah, so like, minus 10 minus 5 makes it minus 15.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, that is what I did wrong. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Okay. No problem. Okay, fine. So now we can go with the next question.
Excuse me, sir.
Yeah?
So I have a doubt in a previous question.
In this cuboid problem, is it?
Hello?
You're not audible. Yeah?
Hello?
Yeah, please go ahead.
Yeah, I was telling that in the height, we have to only subtract 2.5 once, right? Why do we have to take it two times? Because the upper side is open.
No, no, that's what I told in the beginning. This figure is just to show the thickness. It's not open. This is not the real picture of the question. Yeah. This is just to show the thickness, yes. Okay?
Thank you, sir. Yeah.
Yeah. So now our next question is, this is again something with log functions. So now a function is given to us, like f of x is equals to this, and g of x is log x to the base 10, and h of x is a composite function of g of f of x, okay? So in other words, it's basically log of f of x, right? So if this is the case, then choose the set of correct options regarding h of x, okay? So your options are, domain of h of x will be r. H of x is an even function. H of x is positive for all r, and h of x has at least one asymptote. Okay, so you can check for asymptote here and try to plot the graph of h of x here. So here, this type of question, it becomes important, you know, when you to plot a graph. So I'll give you 5 minutes. Okay. Yeah.
Yeah. Can you please clarify about asymptote again?
So now you have to check the asymptote for this function h of x.
No, can you like,
what
this
is asymptote?
This must be very silly, but I don't know what is asymptote. I don't remember.
Okay, fine. No problem. No problem. So basically, like, asymptote is the value of any value. Like, let's say at x, I'll just draw a graph and explain to you. So, you know, like, log functions are generally like this, okay? Okay?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, what happens is, for what value of x? So, let's say if this is my function log x, okay? So, what will be the value for log 1? Log 1 is?
0.
Log 1 is 0, right? So, log 1 is 0, which is this point. And at what value of x does it goes to infinity? So when you give x equals to 0, this log function goes to infinity, correct?
Yes, sir.
Negative
minus
infinity.
Infinity.
Yeah, so basically a minus, yeah, infinity. So that x becomes, that value of x becomes an asymptote. So at 0 for this function log x, 0 is the asymptote, okay?
Okay, so the value for which the function goes to infinity is 0. Is the asymptote.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So I was giving the mock test right now. So level of difficulty is same, will be same in the NTM exam.
Yeah, it will be very similar.
Very similar. Okay. Yeah. Sir.
Very similar. In fact, easier than this. Like, we have made it easy paper this time.
Okay.
Yeah.
Can I ask something about this particular question?
Yeah, sure. Go ahead.
Sir, the question, the hint given says try to plot the graph for h of x. Now, in the exam hall, we won't be having access to any graphing tool. So we'll handmade graphs.
You don't need a graphing tool. You don't need a graphing tool for this. You can, so plot a rough plot. No, I mean, just try to give a rough plot for this. Yeah.
Okay.
That is just to give a visualization for yourself.
Sure.
Okay, so I'll give you 5 minutes. So I think, like, I already gave you 2 minutes. So you have another 3 minutes, and then we can take this question. We can go with the solution for this.
This question is in the mock test?
Yeah, this is in the mock. It's like exactly the same question.
Given that fx is a quadratic.
Okay.
Sir, we cannot put all values of fx in gx, right?
Why?
Because, sir, some of them will be negative and less than 0 also.
So that's what the thing is. That's why this question is, you know. Then let's say if you have a quad, no, I'll give you that explanation when I'm telling you the solution. For time being, try by yourself. So it depends, right? Like, if your quadratic equation, it depends like how many solution it has got, whether it has got two solution. You should basically check for its, you know, where does it? Yeah, exactly. So you got the thing.
But sir, it has no real solutions.
So if it has no real solution, that means it's never going to give you negative values, right?
Yes.
It's going
sir.
To lie somewhere above y. Yeah.
Yes.
Sir,
yes,
in the third option, h of x is positive for all r, do we exclude the cases in which the h of x is giving us not defined as an answer?
Do you have such cases?
Yes sir, because if it goes to negative,
yeah, for what value? For what value it goes to negative? Check that.
Here it is not giving any solution only.
Yeah, so that means it's never going to be negative.
Okay, sir. It will always be in the first quadrant.
You can't say first quadrant. You can say above y axis. Above x axis, I'm sorry. Yeah.
But sir, the output that comes out of fx can still be negative, right?
Tell me a value where you get negative.
Okay, got it. Never happens,
yeah?
Right?
Check its discriminant.
Yes, sir, it's always positive.
Yeah. So I could say like 21 responses. There are like somewhat 58 participants. So
excuse me, sir.
Yeah.
Will the nature of the graph change change with the base of the log that we take instead of log 10? If we take log e or log some other base.
It does change. If it is,
the shape of the graph.
It does change.
Okay.
If your base is less than one. It does changes. If it is greater than one, it remains more or less the same. So for all those values,
sure,
for those base who's lesser than one, they will have a similar nature, and all those base which with greater than one will have a similar nature. Okay. Clear?
Thank you.
So 25 responses.
Sir, do we define even and odd function?
Do we define even and odd function?
For log, because log functions look very different from the others that we deal with.
So you know, like, how does even function look like? If let's say if I have given you a graph, okay, so how does even function look like? It will be symmetric about
it
the y-axis.
Yeah. Right.
Don't take that thing. It bounces back. It doesn't make that should not be a criteria. It should be it is symmetric about y-axis. Okay, keep that in mind.
Okay.
So if this is the case, let's say this is also bouncing back, but this is not even function. Consider this. This is even function because it is symmetric about y-axis. Okay. This is not even. This is not even. This is even. It is symmetric about y-axis. Okay. Or else you can check for this. F of minus x should be equals to f of x. Give some value for minus x and then see. Okay. F of x, if it is equals, f of minus x is, if it is equals to f of x, then it is an even function. Or in other words, like if you are using graph, then you see like this. In graphical, when you see a graph, it will be symmetric about the y-axis. Okay. Even functions. All right.
So the first one that you drew will be an odd function.
No. That is neither even nor an odd. So for odd functions are generally symmetric. Obviously, I'll just annotate and show you. So basically, an odd function is symmetric about origin, or it's always like for, you know, like you can just draw an imaginary line here. So basically, an odd functions are symmetric about origin. This is something we tell, even told in the lecture. But generally, odd functions are symmetric about y is equals to minus x. Okay. If I draw a function like this, is this symmetric about y-axis?
No, sir.
I mean, this is okay. This is, the figure is of course not symmetric about, you know, even origin as well. So let's not get into this for time being. But for what you can always understand is like, an even function is symmetric about y-axis, where an odd function is symmetric about origin, or you can say y is equals to minus x. An odd function is symmetric about y is equals to minus x. Okay. So you can see some of the, you know, these questions are given in, you know, like quizzes as well, and also on the practice assignments and graded assignments. You can just go through these parts. Okay. How is this even and odd function? How does it graphically look like? Okay, you can just quickly go through it, brush up your concept, and if you still have a doubt, you can post it in the discussion forum. Okay, but there are ample of questions on this. You know, you can practice on this. All right, so I think I have given a lot of time for this. So let's see responses, like 31 response. So we can see some of you are given answers C, D, A, C, D, A, B, C, D. H of x is positive for all r, b, a, b, c, d are correct, a, c. So like very diverse answer. So I see like most of you are giving answer a, a, c, a, d, c. Okay. Okay. So let's see the solution then. So if I can see here, the domain of h of x will be r, that is something right. And h of x is an even function is wrong. H of x is positive for all r. Is again right. A h of x has at least one asymptote is a wrong option. Okay, so now let's quickly see how does this happen. All right, so a rough diagram, so Desmos plot for this is something looks like this. So we are again not interested here. So basically we are interested in here to plot this. So what should be the first step for you is to check the discriminant of the given function, right? So the quadratic function was given to you x square minus 6x plus 11. So what we can do is, like, we can first try and understand discriminant will give you an idea how many root does it have, right? If it has got a single root, that means it will touch the x-axis at one point. If it has got a two roots for a quadratic function, if it has got a two roots, that means it's going to touch the x-axis at two different places, right? So if that is the case, and if discriminant is greater than zero, if discriminant is greater than zero, that means it's never going to touch the x-axis. That means it's above x-axis. In other words, this is always going to give you a positive value, right? All good for now?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So discriminant part is done. Okay. So since we know the discriminant of that quadratic function is positive, that means it's always going to give you a positive value. That means my log function is well defined for all r, correct? I can take any value of x. I can take any value of x. It's always going to give me positive y, positive value, right? Right? So how does? So if I can.
Why is it positive always?
Yeah, I'll tell you why. Because if discriminant, let's say d discriminant d is zero, okay, then the curve will touch the x-axis at one point. Okay, if discriminant is lesser than zero, it will touch the x-axis at two different points. And right. If discriminant is greater than zero, it's going to lie above x-axis, right?
Right.
And log of that quadratic function, which is always giving me positive value, will again be a positive, right?
Yeah.
Right? So it's always going to lie, because my log function is defined for all positive values, correct? So when x square minus 6, this quadratic function, log of this quadratic function, which is always giving me a positive value, that means my log function is well defined, right? For all x. So no matter what value of x you give for this quadratic function, this is always going to give me positive value, right? So h of x is positive, isn't it? Any doubt, sir? As if
no, sir.
Okay.
No.
Sir, I have a doubt.
Yes, please.
Is it not like all log functions are supposed to have an asymptote?
It depends, no? So wherever the log, see, log 0 will give you an asymptote, right? Log of a 0, log of 0, that log of anything,
yes,
that value which gives you. But here nothing will give you 0, isn't it? No values is giving you 0, isn't it?
Because all the inputs are positive.
All the inputs are positive, right?
Okay.
So we get an asymptote whenever we have a zero for log.
So basically log zero is nothing but an infinity. So wherever it forms an infinity, right, that becomes your asymptote point. If say,
okay.
So if I give you a function log of just give me a minute. Can you see my screen, all of you?
So we can.
Yes, sir. Yes, so we can.
What will be asymptote for this?
Equal to 1.
Yeah. So can you tell me the person who have doubt in this asymptote problem? What will be the asymptote?
Yes, sir, now I've got it.
You got it, right? So at x, yes, you will find its asymptote.
How do you calculate the asymptote?
So it's basically like clearly this value. Asymptote is like whatever function is given inside, just equate to zero. Okay, if that is given like x minus 1, if it is zero, so for x equals to 1, when I substitute x equals to 1, this will make it 0. So log 0 is nothing but infinity. So whichever value which gives me infinity, that value becomes an asymptote point. So here at 1, I see this is going to be an asymptote. So this function is going to be like this.
Okay.
What is log x? Log 0 will give me this thing, right? So for this, the asymptote will be somewhere. Asymptote is 0. So this is going to be something like this. And this is 1. Okay, so asymptote is that value of x wherein it goes to infinity, or like plus infinity, minus infinity.
Sir,
okay,
infinity clear? For y-axis.
Infinity for y-axis.
Sir, could it be for x-axis also?
Yes, you can have.
Okay.
Take an exponential function.
Yeah.
Okay, So when you give an exponential function, something like this. So what do you see? At y equals to 0, this is going to infinity, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So this is an asymptote for me. Okay?
Yeah. Okay, thank you.
So clear? Now I'll take that thing.
Yeah, yeah.
Because we need to finish slides as well. So all right. So this part is clear, like where it forms an asymptote and where not. So what I see please.
Can a log function have more than one asymptote?
Yes, definitely it can have. In the previous example, which is shown to you, that.
And the roots
say,
of the.
Wait. Can you tell me how many asymptotes are there for this?
Yeah,
two asymptotes.
Obviously,
negative,
right?
Negative 2 and 1.
Exactly. So no, so at x equals to minus 2, you will see one asymptote coming. And at x equals to 1, you will see another asymptote. So this graph is going to be something like this. Okay.
So then how did you know that it will be to the negative infinity and not the positive infinity?
Simple. You take all values. So this is, if this is minus 2, right? And this is plus 1. So now take the value as right. Minus 3. Take a value as minus 3. What do you get from here? Minus
2. What?
Sorry? Take x as equals to minus 3. So if you give minus 3, so this will become, so this is going to be minus 4 times. Here, this is minus 1. So this gives me what? Plus 4, right?
Right.
This is log of some positive value will give me some positive value itself. And whenever I'm increasing the negativity of this, this value is again going to increase, right?
Right, right.
Take all the negative value and this is going to increase like this. But take 0 in this, then x is equals to 0, so you get what? Minus 2. So you see this is not defined region. Correct?
Right.
Yeah. So that is
right. Excuse me, sir.
Yeah.
Will I be right in saying that for all discriminant, for all, when the discriminant is less than 0, that it doesn't have an asymptote?
When discriminant is less than 0?
Yeah, that's when it doesn't have real roots. When you take a log of that function, will it never have an asymptote?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
You can always say that, yeah. Okay, so now I will take up that. So now in this, the discriminant was greater than 0, so it is never going to have an asymptote because there is no value x where it tends to infinity. Yes, please go.
I have a quick question about the question number 7 that is given in the mock test. So here we have a leading term. We have a function m of n, and we have a leading term minus n squared. So do we take the square of minus n or n is separate? I mean, like if we square n and then append the minus sign before it, or is it minus n squared?
It's not minus n the whole square.
Okay.
It's just n.
So it's just n square and the leading term has negative sign.
Right.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Yeah, you're welcome. All right. So now we can see here, you know, like it has got no asymptotes. So that is something we can get it from there. Also, now I can just find out like what is the least value of this quadratic equation. Now least value will be at vertex. Now why am I finding the least value of that quadratic equation? It's just because that will give me an idea like where does this log function take me. Like that will be a turning point for this graph. So basically, the vertex for this is going to be, how do you get the vertex? Like in a general formula of g of x equals to ax square plus bx plus c. The vertex is given by minus b by 2a, comma g of minus b by 2a, right? So now we can compare this coefficient. I think all of you know how do we get the vertex point, correct? I hope that all of you know. Do any of you have a problem with finding the, the vertex points?
So I think it should be 3,2.
3,2. For
yes, sir.
Quadratic equation.
Yes, sir. The vertex is at 3,2. It's written that the least value is 0.3.
Okay. Yeah, thanks for pointing this. So basically, yes, you are right. It's going to be 2 here. This is something I have taken
yes,
from the log function and I've written it by mistake here. I'm sorry about this.
Yes, sir. Yes. I understood.
Yeah. So thanks for pointing this. So this is going to be at 3, 2. Okay. Good, you are working out. So now what we can say is, now at 3, now we can substitute these values and try and understand. Now come to step 3.
Excuse me, sir.
Hmm?
I think what you have written is correct, because f of minus b by 2, I say, wouldn't that be 0.301, the log function of 3?
No, so basically, like, actually I was doing for this quadratic function only, because
okay, so here f is this quadratic function.
No, that is, yeah, f of x is my quadratic function, h of x is my log of that function, right?
Okay, sir, thank you.
Yeah, so you pointed it out, right? So there's something, I'll correct it. All right, so now come to the step 3. Now f of x increases as x increases for x in minus infinity to 3. Okay, so why did we find, we just found out the vertex so that I can substitute this 3 here in my h of x function. So when I substitute this 3 in h of function, this will give me a value, like, you know, this is going to be a 0.301 or something, like h of x will give me that value. So I'm not interested in 0.301, but I'm interested in that vertex value. So that is the point wherein I will use it for plotting the graph. So now I'll use, like, from minus infinity to that least point, what will be the nature of this curve? So what I notice is, when I substitute the values, so if I substitute the value, the negative values, so as f of x increases as x decreases in this interval, and similarly it goes with the h of x also, h of x increases as x decreases for x belonging in this region, minus infinity to 3. So now in step 3, again, when you see f of x increases as x increases in this interval, and similarly it goes with h of x as well. So you can substitute the values, like 1 or 2 points, and get the rough diagram for this. Okay. So that is how we can create a rough diagram for h of x functions. All right. So now it is given that domain of h of x will be R is a correct option. So what will be the reason for that? The reason is very straightforward, because you have found out the discriminant value, right? And the discriminant value was positive, right? And therefore, it was a well-defined function for all the value of x. And h of x is an even function is incorrect options, which you can understand from the graph as well, or you can substitute this. You can apply this condition, f of minus x is equals to f of x. If this turns out to be true, then it is even function, otherwise it is not, okay? Okay, and h of x is positive for all r is again a correct option. This is something we have explained you earlier. And h of x is has at least one option is an incorrect option. It's because we could see, like, there are no values of x wherein my log of x tends to infinity. So it has got no asymptote at all. All right. So as if now in doubt.
Yes, sir. Sir, how did we conclude that it's not symmetric about y-axis? Because there is no reason why we should think it's not symmetric.
See, symmetric in the sense, this condition has to be satisfied. See, when you give, so I'll show you here in this notepad, okay? So when I use this, you're able to see my screen, right?
Yes, sir.
How does the graph look like for this? Okay. Now let me take an equation y is equals to x, okay? Or let's take some
symmetric,
x
sir.
Square. So when you give f of minus 1 to this, what do I get? F of minus 1 is what? 1. And f of 1 is 1.
Also 1.
Correct? So I see what? Yes. When I give it minus 1 and 1, I get 1, 1 value. So this is going to be somewhere here and here.
Yes, sir.
Right? Similarly, yes. When I give 2, let's say f of minus 2, what do I get f of minus 2? Substitute in this.
Yes, sir. 4
this is
and
my
4.
F of x function. So I gave it 4, and for this also I get it 4. So 4. For 2, I get 4 somewhere here. Similarly, I get this. So what do I say? This is something symmetric about y-axis, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
See this? Symmetric about y-axis. So that's why we say, when you're seeing a graph, just see whether it is symmetric about y-axis. In that case, in the previous thing, the graph was like this. So if I take now, what was the function? Log of x square. Can somebody tell me what was the function?
X square minus 6x plus 11, sir.
6x plus 11. Okay. Now I will substitute that thing here. Now if I say this is my f of x. No, this is my h of x. Let's take it as h of x. So this is going to be log of x square minus 6x plus 11, correct? So now this should satisfy. If it is an even function, then h of minus x should be equals to h of x, right? Okay. So now if I take, let's say, h of 1, right? So if I take h of 1, what will this give me?
Log of 1 minus 6 plus 11.
Log. So this will give me 6 plus 1, 7. So this is minus 5. So this is going to be 6, right?
6. Right.
And what is h of minus 1?
Okay. Plus 6 plus 11. Not same.
So it's not same, right? So this is not a function. Okay.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Sir?
Yeah.
Can I ask a question just related to this particular topic? I mean, the symmetricity.
We can just speed up now. Yeah, please.
Yeah. Sir, can you go to the original graph of the log function? The slide in peer deck.
Okay. Yeah.
So here, like visually, we can understand that it is not symmetric with respect to the y-axis.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if the point of the least value, like here it there is a depression at x equal to 3. Now, if this were this depression, if this were at around x equal to 0, then could we have safely said that this function is even, the log function?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Okay. So, should we go now next?
Hi, sir. I have a query.
Yeah.
I'm not sure if it's I missed something, but the discriminant in this previous question, it was less than 0.
Yeah.
So if it is discriminant less than 0, then will we have real rules?
Okay, so if discriminant is less than 0, you will not have any real roots. If discriminant is equal to 0, you will have one real root. And if discriminant is greater than 0, you will have two real roots for a quadratic equation.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, but how did you make this hypothesis that if it is less than 0, so x square minus 6 is always positive? I'm not able to get that relation, like how we are able to infer that.
So can I explain this?
Yeah, please go ahead.
Actually, when you get the discriminant, you know that the equation won't have any real roots. Now, if you want to confirm that it's positive, you can just get you can see the equation and you can get the point of minima. The point of minima is positive, and from that you can make out that the equation will always have a positive value.
Okay, got it.
Yeah.
So that negative discriminant was like somehow bothering me. So I got the.
All right. Yeah. Nice. Okay. So we can take up the next question here.
So just one thing, sir. Here, x equal to 3 was not an asymptote, like just.
Here, no, because when you substitute this 3 value in your h of x, what do you get value? It's not tending to infinity.
Finite
right?
value. Okay.
Yeah, that's a finite value. That's why it's not an asymptote. Okay.
But like we can draw it like means what by definition we tell asymptote. Like what is the exact definition?
So definition is like for what value of x your function goes to infinity.
Either infinity, like y or x, something must be at infinity.
It can be either y or x. Yeah, any of these things can be at infinity.
Okay.
X or y, like for what value of x or a y, your function goes to infinity. Okay. That value of x or y is asymptote. Clear?
Could you explain that once more, that the function being positive when this was okay. imaginary, the roots were imaginary.
Okay, so I'll do one thing.
If it's only based on the minima, if you cannot directly found out the minimum and not found out the discriminant.
Discriminant problem.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
Discriminant being imaginary, the roots yeah. still.
Okay, do you remember this formula, quadratic equation formula? We have
minus b plus minus plus or minus b square. Yeah.
B square minus 4ac
yeah,
by.
Yeah. By 2a. Okay.
If let's say this part is negative,
then it's imaginary.
Give you complex root.
Yeah.
Right.
Correct.
So, yeah. So this is what your discriminant is. If this becomes negative, that means you are getting a complex root. That means it has got no real roots.
Right.
That's all.
Yeah, that I got. But then how come the function is positive for all after that?
So if you're getting a complex root, then your function, you will get a graph something like this. It's never going to touch x-axis. You got it?
Okay.
This is one understanding you have to make.
Yeah, 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 yeah. Yeah, that I know. Never
so that is the click.
Okay,
this will never give you negative value, no? This function will never give you negative value. For any value of x, no matter what value of x you take, it is never going to give me negative value, right?
Okay.
Yeah. So that is the thing. Okay. So now I'll take up this next question.
Yeah.
One question.
Yes.
Sir, in that log function, you said that there can be an asymptote at y as well.
Yeah. Not for log. For exponential function.
For exponential function.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Yeah, you're welcome. Okay, now let's take question number 4. So here, let p of x and q of x be a polynomial of degree 4. And suppose p of x is equals to q of x for 4 different real values of x. Let's say alpha, beta, gamma, delta. Now these are the values where, you know, p of x becomes equals to q of x. Okay. Now, which of the following may represent the polynomial p of x minus q of x? Now you have to choose the correct options. Okay. So basically here there is an error from my end. I did not change the option over here. So the question is this, which of the following may represent the polynomial p of x minus q of x?
Sir, what is the error? Can you repeat?
Yeah, this is not the question.
Okay.
The question is this.
Okay, got it.
So we'll give you some 5 minutes and take and solve it.
Sir, just like as was done in the previous mock tests, will we get a detailed solutions PDF before the entire exam?
For this mock, is it?
Yeah.
You'll get it.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
The the solutions for both the equations are alpha, beta, gamma, and delta?
Yeah.
Okay.
So I will advise everyone to, you know, solve mock paper once, if it even after it is done, solve 2-3 times and go for your term exam, because the questions will be very similar. Like, let's say if this is question number 4, like the question which I have shown you here, you will have a similar question, but you will have a similar question. So if you are able to solve this, then obviously you will be able to solve that questions. So do pay attention to the mock questions.
Excuse me, sir.
Yeah.
Could I know another source where I could get similar questions to practice on?
See, I'll tell you, because there is limited time, because you people have to go through the other subjects as well. So what you can do is, you can actually go with the mock questions, what we'll provide, I mean, whatever you'll get, and we'll also give you the detailed solution, solve them, okay? And also, like, we are giving you a blueprint of the questions, like, wherein you can which portion and which part of the questions you have to, I mean, which section you have to focus more. So you can practice only those questions. Let's say for week 12, we say, like, you know, you can focus on DAG, you can focus on Dijkstra algorithm, or like Floyd-Warshall or Bellman-Ford or anything. So if that is something particularly mentioned, practice the questions of only that, okay? You don't really have to solve everything of that thing. So you can take that, you know, as one feedback from
you. Thank
you. If you want to practice, yeah, you can do that. Like, just focus on the specific thing what is mentioned in the blueprints.
Okay. Sir,
mm-hmm.
I had something to say earlier. Mm-hmm. When I said that in the announcement tabs, they have uploaded it. So I just checked. Mm-hmm. It's there for CT, it's there for statistics, but for maths, it isn't there. So I got confused. Okay. Just wanted to clarify.
I told you before that.
Okay.
I'm sorry.
No problem. Yes. But actually, like, we have circulated emails within ourselves. So I was not sure whether it has been uploaded or not. But yeah, we have made the blueprints and we'll share with you. Okay. Once it gets rectified from all of us.
Okay. Sir, the preparation session we have had yesterday, will we get the PDF of that or not?
Yesterday's Srikant session, is it?
I think
okay. So what, like, the preparatory sessions, what you heard?
Rahul sir session, sir.
Okay, let me check if he has saved that PDF or not. Oh yeah, he will be sharing with you that PDF. Like,
yeah, he has, but he said he need to confirm from the administration.
All right. So we can actually we can discuss among ourselves and then we'll see if we can share.
Yeah.
To you. Most likely it can be shared.
Yeah,
it was helpful notes. So, all right, let me see how many responses as of now. Seems like some 10 responses. Okay. So, I'll give you 2 more minutes. Do anybody want some more time, or should I go with the solution?
I need a hint to start the solution.
Okay, you want the hint. So I can give you one hint. Is you can use this itself as a hint, px minus qx equals to 0. See, or otherwise, just forget everything. Think, if the roots are given, like alpha, beta, gamma, delta are the roots, okay, then how do you write in the factor form? How do you write x minus alpha?
Sir, it is not given that it is roots, na? It is said that p of x is equal to q of x.
Yeah, so this is the part you have to understand. P of x equals to q of x. That means p of x minus q of x will make it 0, right?
Yeah.
And that's how you will get your root. So that was something, you know, you have to understand with. And this is given, logic. P of x. That is some logic you have to catch. And make sure, like, this is something we'll play around even in your term one. So pay attention to this, okay?
Okay. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you're. So, do you want some more time?
What you just said? I did not catch you.
Okay. So, okay, I'll come to that solution part, then I'll explain you, okay? So, do you want some more time or should I go ahead?
So, continue.
Yeah, okay. So, I can see most of you are giving answer as B, and that is the right answer. So, let's see. 16 of you have given, out of 17, 16 of you have given an answer as B, and that is right answer. So, how do we solve this? So, it is given that P of X is equals to Q of X at four different real values of X, and where, you know, X, where X belongs to alpha, beta, gamma, delta, which implies what? P of X minus Q of X equals to zero, correct? Now, when I say that some equation is giving me zero, that means P of X minus Q of X, so this alpha, beta, gamma, delta becomes my root, correct? All of you are with me?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Correct.
Okay. So if that is the case, and it says, now what I have done here is I have eliminated the options. What you can do is other way around. Since alpha, beta, gamma, delta are given as the roots, so what you can quickly do is, I'll open my notepad here. One way of doing is, P of X minus Q of X was giving me zero, right? And if this is the case, and they are saying alpha, beta, gamma, delta are some roots and C is some constants. If these are roots, then how can I write this? X minus alpha times X minus beta times X minus gamma times X minus delta is equals to zero. And C was some arbitrary constant, which is, yeah.
Sorry to interrupt, but I had to ask something regarding this line that you wrote. P of X minus Q of X equal to zero. This for all values of X or only for the given values, alpha, beta, gamma, and delta?
Only for given value, alpha, beta, gamma, delta. That is something told.
Okay, sir. Okay, sir. Thank you.
Right? And so if that is the case, then this is something how my equation is going to look like. Right? I can see in second option, these two options are given for me. Correct? In second option. So your second option is something here, if you are not able to see. Here second option gives me this, gamma and delta. I can see nowhere here this is given plus and this is given plus. So I can quickly rule out these two things and I can accept this B as my option. I no need to play around, right? All of you are with me now?
Sir.
Yeah. So this is one way of doing it.
And how have you, crossed off option A from the answers?
So see here, if I equate this to zero, x to the power of 4 plus alpha equals to zero, what do I get? X to the power of 4 is equals to minus alpha. That gives me some complex value, right?
Yes, sir.
Right? But what am I saying? Alpha, beta, gamma, delta are some constant, right?
Roots. Yes,
yeah,
sir.
So that is one way of doing it. That is like quickest way of doing it. Otherwise, we can come to this part. If I see option A, and if this I'm equating to zero, option one, so C times X to the power of 4 plus alpha is equals to zero has no solutions. But we say like there are four solutions for this. Yes.
So,
please go ahead.
Could be negative also.
Yeah, it can be.
Then how should we write as X minus alpha into X minus beta? How could we confirm it as?
How do you confirm that, is it?
Yes.
No, see, when you say like roots can be negative as well. So, but what are we saying here is alpha, see, alpha is one of my root, isn't it? Can you tell me alpha, is alpha equals to minus alpha, is right? Alpha is never equals to minus alpha, isn't it?
Yes.
But my roots are what? Minus alpha, beta, gamma, delta. Right?
Yes.
Yeah. So that's how we can rule out that. So in option four, so if you have understood what I have explained you on the notepad, you really no need to do all this. This is just for ruling out an option what I have given you. In option two, you can see here, this was given C times X square minus alpha plus beta, X plus alpha, beta, times X minus gamma times X minus delta is equals to zero has four solution. How is it done? See, one way of also doing this problem is just substitute alpha value beta value, gamma value, delta value. If it is giving you zero, then yes, it is. Okay. So now here, what I can do is I can easily factorize this and I get two values. That is x is equals to alpha, x is equals to beta. Here x minus gamma is equals to zero. So x gives me gamma. And here x minus delta. So x gives me delta. So for your question, what you told, like how if it is negative, then how does it look like? Okay. So now come to this part. Now in option four, fourth point. Okay. So when I say x plus delta is equals to zero, which implies x is equals to minus delta. But what you notice, minus delta is not same as delta. And what are we saying? Delta is one of the roots. Correct?
Yes,
but
sir.
These two are not the same thing. That is why this is not acceptable. Okay. So if all of you are with me, I can go to the next part of the question. I mean, next question.
So I have a small doubt.
Yes, please.
In this, I may have missed this during the lecture, so I'm not sure.
Mm-hmm.
But how do you determine that the roots of px minus qx are also alpha, beta, gamma, and delta?
No, because here we are saying, in the question, if you can read, suppose p of x and q of x for four different real values of x, say this.
Yes.
Right? So p of x is equals to x for four different value of x, correct? And those values are like x is equals to alpha, x is equals to beta, x is equals to gamma, and x is equal to delta. For those values of x, p of x becomes equals to q of x. Okay.
So is there some theorem that, I understood that p of x and q of x, they intersect at these points basically.
Yeah, exactly.
So
I want your assistance for this, so we can solve this together. So now when I say this, so you know when I say equation x square plus 5x plus 4 is equals to 0, and when I say if this is equals to 0, right, and let me say this itself is my f of x minus h of x. Okay. Let me say my f of x minus h of x is this function, and this is equals to zero. So what I'll be interested in, I can factorize this, right? So I can write this in the form x square plus 4x plus x plus 4, right? So I can write this x plus 4, x plus 1, and x plus 4. Right, so I can write this above equation x, the same thing I can write like this, right?
Yes.
Okay. So now your question, what was your question? How do I, can you repeat your question?
How do you determine that alpha, beta, gamma, and delta are roots of px minus qx?
P of x minus qx. Okay. So if now say this is like reverse type of questions I have given. Okay. So if I say here alpha, let me say here for this f of x minus h of x, I know the roots are this. So if I am a framer of a question, what I'll say, my alpha is minus 1 and my beta is minus 4. So now I will say f of x minus h of x is equals to 0, or in other words, I'm just doing the reverse of this thing. Okay, reverse. I know my roots, okay, alpha and beta. Okay, and I'm doing the question framing of this. So f of x is equals to h of x at two values of x, and those are these values. Okay, those are these values. So from here, what I can do one intuition is f of x minus h of x is going to give me 0, and then I can do all these parts and then come to this.
Okay, now I understood.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So, sir, is it necessary for them to intersect at the roots itself?
That is what we are telling in the question.
That's because it's on the it's based on the question from the question.
Sir, functions P and Q will have different values of C, right?
C we are not playing at all. C is just an arbitrary constant wherein, you know, C will not do anything for its root. It will just amplify your equations. That's all. But the roots will remain same. Even if it is negative or positive, it doesn't matter. Okay.
Sir,
may I just
If they are the exact same thing, won't the entire thing become zero? Sir, if P and Q have all the roots also same and C also same, then the answer will become zero.
No, see, this is something we are saying. P of x equals to Q of x for these values of x, alpha, beta, gamma, delta. For those values of x, it is becoming zero. Yeah. Anybody else? Any doubt here?
Sir. In option number A, C x 4 plus alpha. If alpha is minus 1, sir, we'll get a root. That was my doubt, sir.
Okay. So if sir, you get
alpha is suppose minus 1, then
okay.
Yes, sir.
Right, so your x square is equals to alpha, x to the power of 4 is alpha, right?
Yes, sir.
So it can take negative values of alpha, positive values of alpha, right?
Yes, sir.
But this negative value of alpha is not same as positive value of alpha.
Okay, sir.
So we are just playing around with this positive thing. Okay.
Okay, sir. Okay. Yeah, thank you, sir.
You're welcome. So now next question is, now we have been given a sets for you like A, B, C, and then we are asking you what is the cardinality of A minus B union C union B minus A union C union C minus B union A. So this is something you have to find out. What is the cardinality of this? Okay. So one hint I can give you is something given here, cardinality of A intersection A minus B union C is nothing but its number of elements in A, but not in elements, but not in set B nor in set C. The best way of doing is draw a Venn diagram and solve.
Sir, in the previous question, there was C into X plus alpha the whole 4, right? Raised to the power of 4.
X to the power of 4 plus alpha.
Yeah. So when we said that there will be 4 different roots, will that be ruled out automatically? Because
yeah, exactly.
Exactly.
Okay. That will rule out automatically. Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you.
So can you tell me where I can practice questions of SSE, because I have a lot of problems with SSE.
Okay, SSE. All right. So SSE, like, it was done in week 4, right?
Yes, sir.
So you have been given a lot of questions in related to that. And see, one more thing, in quiz 2, even in quiz 3, we have given questions related to SSE. So you can practice those
and
questions.
Every time I almost freeze when that question appears because I don't know anything. I can't understand how to progress with the sum.
Okay, let me know how much you know about this. What is the least value of SSE?
Don't know, sir.
Okay.
So, is it zero?
Yeah, exactly. It's zero. So least value of SSE is zero. It can never be negative. Okay. So if it is zero, that means it is the best fit. Okay. So I can understand this. So what you can do is, like, there are some questions, like you can get easily some 5-6 questions related to SSE. So you can see lecture, you will have in lecture one question you will have. Then in another additional lecture, there is one more question on SSE. I think in tutorial also there is one question on SSE. In practice assignment also, or graded assignment, there is one question. And quiz 2 and 3, there is SSE. You have 6 questions of SSE you can practice.
So even 2-3 question of SSE in the statistic, in the best line fit.
So you can get there as well. So you have some questions. So you can solve them if you... Yes?
Yeah, but to be honest, the way in which SSE was introduced in the lectures, that was actually confusing. Even I struggled with SSE initially because the lecture was, it was not elaborate enough. That is what I feel.
Okay, fine. Yeah. So what we have done is we have created one additional lecture also. That is something, I don't know, like, whether you guys have it or not, but the new batch students who are coming, I think they have that additional video lecture, I guess. Which will be updated in our portal as well, like your student, student portal. So I think there is that lecture. I don't know, like, whether I need to check that really. So let's go with this question. I can see like 12 of you have responded to this. And it's already 9, so we can just speed up now. So I can see like 18 of you have responded. Do you want some more time or should I go with the solution? Do any of you need some time?
Few seconds, sir.
Okay. Few seconds.
Okay.
So I had another doubt.
Mm-hmm.
With BFS, do we go for the smallest, in the sense if we have three edges, so when we proceed, do we go to the smallest edge first, in the sense now in this question, 0 is connected to 1, 2 and 3, so will it go to 1 first and travel?
Oh, in the mock you are asking, is it?
Yeah, this is just for an example, but I wanted a broader
So you can, in broader picture, you can keep always in your mind, like you can have edges between same level and also one level above, one level below. So you can have edges on the same level and also one level above and below. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So let me see now how many, 26 responses. So I could see like most of you are giving answer as 9. Okay. Strange. Some of you have given answer as, so it's between, yeah, so most of you have given answer as 9. Okay. So those person who have included, who are getting 9, are you considering 0 as also this thing, is it?
No, so null set, it will be a...
So all right, so let's see how does it look like. Okay, so do all of you got set A as this? 3 6 9 12 15 18 21 24, all of you got that?
Yes sir.
Set B is 4 8 12 16 20 24, set C is 6 12 18 and 24, right? So what we can do is we can find out, we can just draw a Venn diagram for this. Okay, and then we do,
so we don't need to consider 0 in this.
No, we are saying no. See here, your x is greater than 1.
Okay.
Yeah? Okay. So if that is the case, then yeah. So you can see here, now we can find all the intersection points. So the intersection of A, B, C. So what you can see is which all values are common. So intersection of A, intersection of B, intersection of C are 12 and 24 only, right? Right? Right?
Yeah.
Anybody any doubt? No doubt. Okay. What is A intersection C? A intersection C will be
6, 12, 18, 24.
It's like very
24 also. Yeah.
Because set 6 contains multiples of 6 and set A contains multiples of 3. So all those factors which are of 6 is also the factor of 3, right? So therefore 6, 12, 18, and 24 comes in. All right. Then what is intersection of B and C?
12 and 24.
So what are the elements left in only A? Those are 3, 9, 15, and 21.
Yeah.
And elements in B only is 4, 8, 16, and 20. And in C, there is no elements left. Only for C only, right? So
yeah.
In the question, we had asked like, so basically like our set A. So if you go with this set A, not B union C. Not B union C means all those elements. So this includes set A, not B union C means it's just A only elements, right? Similarly,
yeah.
Rest all. So what we can do is we can add all of them. So when I see set those things, so these are the elements which are listed. That is 3, 4, 8, 9, 15, 16, 20, 24. And those, the cardinality of that is 8. Correct? But most of you have given answer as 9. I want to know where you missed it.
Sir, I considered 0 also.
Ah, okay.
So sir, but I'm getting 10.
How? Just see this Venn diagram.
Yeah, we understood, sir. It's simple.
Okay. So, so considering now time factor, we can go on to the next question. And like, if you have further doubt, you can go through this Venn diagram again. It's very simple.
Yeah, but sir, in the given set, is 6 considered?
6 is in which?
In the solution set, 6 should be considered, right?
In solution set, 6 should be considered.
Huh.
Why?
That's what I did, but then I realized that 6 is a multiple of 3, so it won't be included, right?
Yeah.
But only if 6 is a multiple of A and C, that means it should not be in B, but it can be in C, right? You are taking the union.
We are taking the union of the elements that are only in one set and not in the other. So 6 is set.
Yes, sir. We are taking the union of A minus B union C, right? So all the elements in A which are not common, which are not common in B and C, right? Which are common in B and C, we are just taking out them from A, right?
Yeah. So when you take B union C, 6 will be included, isn't it?
So
B union C, 6, no, sir.
Why?
B union A,
we take... It's union, it's not intersection. Yeah.
Oh, sorry, I'm taking intersection. Sorry.
Okay.
I was taking
intersection. No problem.
Sir, can I ask?
Please.
Since the number of elements is actually small, we can manually calculate all the sets. But if it's not possible to manually calculate all the 3 sets, is there any way to solve this problem?
So one thing is you have to keep in your mind like the factors like what will be the let's say if I tell like you know multiples of 5, so you can always keep in mind like you know all those number ending with 0 and 5 will be definitely multiples of 5, right?
Yeah.
So those kind of things you can always keep in your mind.
Okay, so
things will be really handy while you're solving these kind of problems. Okay. So fine.
Yeah. Sir, can we take some algo type of question? Yeah.
Algorithm type of questions.
Yeah.
For now, we can just avoid that. You know, like we are not really going into algorithm part. So it's like very straightforward, pure maths. So we can, you know, just stick on to just basic things, what is coming.
Okay, fine.
Of course, like if we would have taught you like, progressions and series, that kind of things, that would have been really, we could have created more questions on algo. So let's not get into all that.
Okay,
so let's go with question 6. And I think this is the last question. After this, we can wind up. So here a graph is given to you. So you can basically read this problem. This is like directly a direct question from the lecture what sir has taken an example. So it's again a very similar type. So here basically there are oil deposits at the vertex, at various vertices, and the edges are the pipelines. And on the edges, what you see is the time duration by which the fire goes to the other oil deposit. So basically A naught is one oil deposit, A1 is oil another oil deposit, and let's say from A naught to A1, if A naught gets fired, so and through this pipeline it takes 4 whatever, like let's say a second, minute or hour or whatever. So we are not interested in unit here. So we say like at this much time it reaches there. So what you have to tell here is, if you set a fire at A naught, okay, then the order in which the oil deposits are burnt will be, okay. So this is a pure question of Dijkstra algorithm. Why we can use? Because all are positive here, okay. So we can use this. So I want you to give me the sequence,
What if fire is reaching at two edges at the same point?
At the same point?
At the same time. Yeah.
So you consider the same time then.
Yeah. So like what will be the order then?
You try doing this, your doubt will get clear.
Okay, sir.
Yeah, try doing this.
Excuse me, sir.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, in this one, I don't think that case actually occurs. But
yeah, exactly. That's what I asked her to solve that.
In the exam, if it does occur, then what
it won't occur. Don't worry. We'll take care of that.
But is there
because of course.
Is there any way Dijkstra's algorithm accommodates this problem?
If that is the case, right? So what we'll do is we'll give you MSQ type. We'll not give you MCQ at that case.
Okay.
Yeah.
So like Dijkstra's algorithm can have multiple outputs then.
Yeah, it depends on the pipeline, like from where you are coming.
Yeah.
Of course, okay. Yeah.
A question on the sides until people solve it.
Okay.
Are you going to revisit these algorithms in later part of this course?
No, actually, since this is extensively covered earlier, so mostly I won't be taking you in much depth of this. What you can do is you can see this week 12 solve with instructor, wherein he has taken it in detail. So that's why I did not cover this part in details here. Because most of these concepts are already covered.
In next terms.
In next terms. Okay, no. So this is something you will get it in CT. Okay. Of course, okay. Graph theory, like application part of it, wherein, of course, the same Madhavan sir will be taking you through. So you will have much better understanding. But mostly you will be dealing with computational, more with algorithm and all that. So computationally, how you will be solving that. So here, maths part, it's just manually how we do. Okay, so of course you will get this graph theory coming up, yes, in CT.
Thank you.
Not in maths again, yeah. So I could see like 22 of you have given response, and I can say like most of you have given D as the answer, and D is okay, and that D is the right answer. So this is the solution. So what we can see is, can anybody take initiative to explain this, or should I explain?
I can try.
Yeah, please go ahead.
Yeah, so the question says that we are setting fire at vertex A naught.
Mm-hmm.
So when we set fire at vertex A naught, the outgoing edges are, the weights of the outgoing edges are 1 and 4. Mm-hmm. So the shortest edge is 1, and that leads to vertex A2. Mm-hmm. From vertex A2, the two edges are weighted 6 and 2. And so the next vertex that will get burnt is A1. Now, we have to keep track of the total time that we are taking, so that it is one unit plus two units, that is 3 units of time.
Mm-hmm.
And from there, there are two options.
Why not, sorry to interrupt, why not A0 to A1, we have 4, why can't we give it 4?
Sir, from A0 to A1, why can't we give it 4?
Yeah, why we are giving 3?
Dijkstra's algorithm is actually giving us the shortest time.
Okay, fine.
So,
yeah.
shortest path is 1 plus 2, that is 3.
Okay.
If that edge from A2 to A1 went there, then the time to burn A1 would have been 4.
Yeah, okay.
And so from vertex A1, we proceed accordingly. We get vertex A3 burns next, then vertex A4, and like that, we complete the whole thing.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, how I solved it was, I was just eliminating the options. I just checked the first, I just checked at the points where there was a mismatch between the options, and they evaluated which one first. So I did not actually go through the whole graph.
All right. So, okay, that's a smart thing you have done. So do all of you understood this? You can match your answers with this here.
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Go on. So, next
this is, yeah, no, there is no more question. We are done for the day. So thank you, everyone. And see, like, if we will be giving you a detailed solution, maybe like tomorrow or day after tomorrow. Most likely day after tomorrow. Tomorrow it's not going to be possible. Tomorrow, like, we ourselves, you know, discuss and do multiple reviews. So that is something we will be doing. So I want to give you one general guidelines for you. Like, do solve these mock questions, because like you get the direct replica of these mock questions in the, you know, most of the questions will have a direct replica in your term one. Okay. And this is very essential. Like, you solve this, solve it multiple times, understand the concept, will provide you the detailed solution. If you have doubt, do post it in the discussion forum, discuss with us. Okay. And we will take up that questions and make sure, like, whatever the announcements is given to you regarding the blueprints of the questions, pay attention to that and focus more on those questions, because there is no other questions we are going to ask. It's only from the blueprint we'll be giving you. Okay. So if you are able to, and by blueprint, what I mean is, like, take up the question from that blueprints, what it is there in the practice graded and, in activity or elsewhere too, and then solve it and do check for, practice multiple times, specifically for the one which is told in the blueprints, and also for the mocks. If in mock, if let's say I've asked you on CAREM problem in the beginning, so make sure you are doing some similar questions, okay, from that part, okay? So that will give you an indication, like, where do this CAREM question came from? Let's say I have taken from the graded assignments. So that should give you a more, inclination towards the graded assignment of that week. Like, you should focus more questions of that type. So you'll get a direct question or direct replica of that type. Okay. So do pay attention, and tomorrow we'll provide you maybe day after tomorrow, the detailed solution of this. Solve it multiple times. Okay. And all the very best. This is the last session for our term one for maths. Okay.
Is it a CAREM question? What did you say?
Sorry?
You were talking about CAREM question.
Yeah, in the beginning I took one CAREM problem, wherein CAREM board problem.
Okay, got it.
Sure. Yeah. So that is something to tell you, like, okay, we have taken one question from the graded assignment. So do pay attention to the questions around the graded assignment of that week, okay? Because you might get a questions. All right. So that is one hint what you can get from my end. And rest all, stick on to blueprints, all right? This is all from my end here.
Something about cross edges, because not discussed in any of the previous sessions.
Sorry, yes, okay, fine. So cross edges, what you see is, it's between two different branches. Basically, let's say you have a branch one, like you have one branch and you have another branch. So on the same level, or if you have an edges connecting these two branches, those are cross edges. Okay.
Sir, can you write somewhere? Yeah, a little better.
Okay. Can we do one thing? Can you post that in the discussion forum? Can I take up that thing in the forum? Will that?
Yes, sir, that can
be. I'm sorry, but yeah, do that.
Yes, it's okay, sir.
It, yeah, because that will be helpful for others as well, of course, over here too. But that is one clear idea, like, just connecting two different branches, that isn't possible. Maybe, like, you post it in a discussion forum, I'll give you a good example and give you a solution for that.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes.
Sir, about the discussion forum, often what happens is the questions are not answered, or they do not tend to be answered by the instructors. Can you ensure that at least in the end of the at end of this term, the questions that are asked are like completed, at least they're answered by the instructors or something like that.
Sure, we'll do that. Mean,
Yeah, okay.
Sir, excuse me, sir.
Yes.
Where we will get the blueprints here that you mentioned?
So you will get it very soon, like maybe tomorrow. Tomorrow you will get the blueprints. So
and that will be available in the dashboard itself?
Yeah, so you will get it in the announcement of your dashboard.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Yeah. So thank you, everyone. Have a good day. I mean,
before we leave, on behalf of all the students, I want to thank you.
Thank you very much, sir.
It was very beautiful session. Nice. Thank you so much.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. Good night.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir.